On September 15, 1916, the Germans would have their first encounter with Britain's attempt to break the stalemate of trench warfare. Multi-ton steel behemoths, belching smoke, equipped with machine guns and cannon, would come lumbering across no man's land, evoking visions of Hannibal. They had to be stopped, and so Germany would reach for an elephant gun. Hi, I'm Othais, and this, oh good lord, is the German Tankgewehr Model 1918. It's an anti-tank rifle, the world's first. Let's get it in the light box before I pull something. At just over 5'5" long and weighing in at 37.7 pounds with this particular bipod, this single-shot anti-armor rifle is just about as big as Mae. It fires the 13.2mm Tank und Flieger cartridge. We'll talk more about that in just a moment. Now, normally I'd set this down and give you a little context, but I think it's going to stay here. Anyway, backing up, let's talk about why this gun was needed. You see, as most of you are aware, you probably are watchers of the Great War Channel, so you know what's going on with the First World War at this point. We have trench warfare, we have no man's land in between, there's all sorts of obstacles, especially barbed wire, and, you know, trying to advance against machine guns is kind of a pain in the butt, a lethal pain in the butt. So, the French and British start experimenting with the idea of just how to get up over that front line. They start looking at, you know, tractors and armored carriers and things like that. And something else that's sort of been in the works just before the war is the advancement of the continuous track tractor. And that's going to be very important because these devices can be elongated in such a way as to be able to cross trenches. And they're also sort of impervious to barbed wire. They're slow, but they can be up-armored, and then they can move forward and protect men, other infantry to the side and behind, as they move up the line. And they're especially good for seeking out machine guns. So, real quickly, this is not a tank history show, but let's just go ahead and point out some of what was up against the Germans in order to make them want this gun. First, this is the Schneider CA-1. Technically not a modern tank, but reasonably it fulfilled the same role in these early days. It carries a 75mm Blockhaus Schneider gun and two Hotchkiss Model 1914 machine guns chambering 8mm lebel. Oh, and let's keep an eye on that armor thickness as we go. Attempting to compete with the Schneider, the Saint-Chamond basically failed. Underpowered and inadequate, it was still a concern for the Germans, though. It carries a 75mm Saint-Chamond Mondragon gun and four Hotchkiss Model 1914 machine guns chambering 8mm lebel. Definitely the most influential tank in the history of tanks, the Renault FT sports the first rotating turret. It carries either a 37mm Pateau SA 1918 gun or a Hotchkiss Model 1914 machine gun, again chambering 8mm lebel. Moving on to Britain, first to the fight was the British Mark I tank. This came in a male and female pattern. The males were armed with two Hotchkiss 6-pounder guns and three Hotchkiss Mark I machine guns, chambering 303. The females were more for infantry defense, and sported four Vickers and one Hotchkiss machine gun, all in 303. An advancement of the Mark I, the Mark IV sports improved armor, better fuel tank placement, and was built to be transported more easily. Again, there would be a male with two Hotchkiss 6-pounders and three Lewis 303 machine guns, or a female with five Lewis guns. Still more improvements netted a heavier armored tank with better steering and armament. Now we can choose between two 6-pounders and four Hotchkiss Mark I machine guns, or six Hotchkiss machine guns in total. The Whippet was meant to be a faster support tank, designed to take advantage of breaks in the line or other battlefield changes. It sports four Hotchkiss Mark I machine guns chambering 303. Now, of course, Germany didn't have to deal with their own tank, but we might as well show it just so you can have some basis of comparison. This is the A7V. It sported six MG08s in 7.92 and generally was armed with a captured 57mm Maxim Nordenfeld gun. Now, if you were watching those figures, you're going to be able to see that there's an extreme disparity of force there. Germany would field 20 tanks against thousands of Entente tanks, and that disparity of force had to be made up somewhere. Number one, first thing though, before this guy rolls out, the Germans would focus on sort of a combined arms strategy. They would direct mortar fire, indirect artillery fire. They would use bundles of grenades and explosives. They would start digging tank traps. There's a lot of ways to stop a tank. They're not impervious. But the problem is, when we sit here and imagine this, we kind of think of a lone tank. What's really happening, though, is you have this creepy crawly approaching you, along with infantry and all the other things that you usually had to deal with in an attack anyway. And what the tank's really doing is it's limiting the ability of your troops to defend themselves with the machine guns and targeting the machine guns. It's basically a machine gun breaker. And that is huge when you're trying to defend against a World War I wave attack. So, while you can stop the tanks those ways, it requires a lot of planning, a lot of coordination, and a lot of indirect fire. And remember, artillery is great at stopping troops in open ground, but you don't have burst shells and things like that when it comes to tanks. You have to hit the tank dead on to stop it. So it really is a hard thing to pinpoint. And so the Germans start looking for direct fire solutions. Now, Germany did have an armor-piercing 7.62 by 57mm cartridge. This Spitzgesschuss-Mit-Stockern, oh god, you guys are going to yell at me for that, ammo sported a tungsten alloy steel core with a heavy powder load. Starting in 1915, before the tank's appearance, they were issued sparingly to marksmen, usually with scoped rifles and sometimes machine guns. They were meant to be used on fortified or steel plate armored targets like snipers' nests and pillboxes. With penetration of roughly 10.5 millimeters of steel at 100 meters, they certainly were a risk to the earliest tanks, but only on key positions with not a lot of energy left once they punched through. While certainly impressive for rifle cartridge, the SMK really wasn't a solution to this new problem. And not only that, it's not just tanks. We also have aircraft showing up in larger and larger numbers and taking on attack roles like low-altitude bombing and strafing. And so, yes, you could chase them away before with your machine guns, but now, well, they're up-armored slowly. They're getting more powerful engines. It's a problem. So the Small Arms Commission in October of 1917 decides that's it, we've had enough, we're taking care of both problems with one big stick. And so they commission orders to create a large bore machine gun designed to take on both tanks and aircraft, a Tank und Flieger machine gun. Production of this wonder weapon was trusted to Maschinenfabrik Augsburg Nuremberg. Now, this was going to be an upscaled MG08. It would actually be ready by war's end, but very few were ever produced as they were just too late to the game, despite orders that they should have been ready by spring of 1918. These were ultimately unrealistic. Luckily for Germany, the initial request for this machine gun went across the desk of Oberlieutenant Peter Reed. Now, he saw basically what we all can see, which is that there's no way you're going to develop a large bore, the biggest single rifle cartridge to date in terms of a personal infantry weapon into a usable machine gun in just a few months. He also realized that in order to even do all that, they were going to need to test the cartridge. And so, at some point, they're going to have to come up with a rifle and some sort of breech system that's rudimentary to contain the thing for testing. Why not go ahead and give it a stock and some legs and get that thing out in the field and take care of half the problem? So he makes the suggestion to the commission that they do a parallel development of a simple, single-shot bolt-action rifle, just something, a stopgap measure, to go ahead and resolve 50% of the issue that they're facing while they're waiting for the rest of this machine gun to be worked up. He's basically hedging his bet, and it's a smart decision. As a matter of fact, the commission sees this, and so they will go to Mauser in November of 1917 and request that they produce exactly that. Unfortunately for Mauser, when the request came in, they still hadn't even decided on the cartridge. They were still ranging from somewhere between 13 millimeters to 15 millimeters in the exact case dimensions. In the end, a 13.2mm bore would win out. This 13.2mm tough cartridge was developed by Polta and Magdeburg. This massive, massive cartridge would go on to inspire a whole host of other anti-material rounds, including the 50 BMG. It sports a jacketed bullet hiding a massive hardened steel core. The case was rimmed for added strength and ease of extraction. Since the two known applications were going to be a Maxim-derived MG and a single-shot rifle, both had been proven to run rimmed ammo just fine. I'd like to point out at this moment we've made all of our cartridge segments to scale with one another, including the size of the ammunition within your frame that you're seeing now. So feel free to bring this up alongside any other for a sense of what we're dealing with here. All of that, plus the twist weight of the rifling and overall dimensions, that was all figured out by January of 1918, so the rest was up to Mauser work, and they were given some special help. You see, an entire infantry design office was taken from Berlin and moved over to Oberndorf. This was headed by Professor Schwerd, and he was assisted capably by the engineer Edgar Haverbeck. Their mission was to help Mauser work go ahead and set up the factory and production lines and tooling as fast as possible, which on its own is no small feat, but also don't forget that at this time, Germany is really rationing everything, and there's a hierarchy to every piece of steel. And so they had to give the Tankgewehr project the same category rating, the same importance rating as new submarine production. So these guys would roll in, they would speed things up radically, they would get everything in place, an entirely new assembly line is done, and the gun and ammo are ready for full production May 10th of 1918. This is one of the fastest development programs for a new rifle and cartridge in military history. And they would quickly ramp production up to 300 units per day. Fantastic. Also, a lot cheaper than tanks, and a lot cheaper than doing a full machine gun production and having to wait on it, too. So at this point, let's stop and take a closer look at this big boy and just what they came up with. The first thing I want you guys to take in is just how big this is, before we go into detail. I mean, I am not a small man, and it's as thick around as my fist. We have a nice, thick receiver. I mean, that wall is massive. The whole thing is roughly based on the Mauser 98 for the most part, although some older designs work their way in. I would start pointing out the little things with the patented plastic pokey hand, but I think it's inadequate for this. My big fingers will work just fine. The whole thing is operated on a single shot rotating bolt action. So if we pop her open and take the bolt out, we're going to see that A, it's gigantic, and B, we have four locking lugs. Let me reinsert her though, because I should probably take you through a quick disassembly. Now, just like the Mauser 98, we're going to flip this safety flag up. Although, and I'm not sure if it's just this one or all of them, I got to give it a little cock in order to get that over. So there's a notch in the cocking piece that fits the rim of this massive spent casing. So we'll give that a grab and a yank back. I'm sorry to hide it on you guys, but I actually have to be able to get my strength on there. And we'll flip that to the vertical position. Ta-da, just like the Mauser 98. So I'm going to lift that bolt, pull her back. I've got a bolt release on the left side that I would love to show you, but I'll just put a picture up because I'm not turning this thing around. I'm going to press back on it, not actually like the Mauser 98. It's actually much more like the Gewehr 88, how it rocks in there. All right, so with this guy out, we can twist our shroud off, and now we have the shroud and included firing pin. If I sort of position this where you can see it, it's just like the 98, except for very, very long. They've also gotten away from using that plunger to keep the shroud from rotating out of battery, so you can't actually knock this out of rotation when the bolt is back. It'd just be kind of hard to do. It's so dang massive. They've also put a little bit more of an inlet for gas shield in here to protect the shooter. And it's much simpler milled. I guess they just didn't want to get into that fine milling, and they wanted to keep things nice and sped up for production. If we look at the bolt body, we're going to see that they did not take the Mauser 98 extractor. Instead, this extractor is a scaled-up version from the Mauser 1889, and we've got three gas relief ports on the right side. The firing pin helps shape everything towards this, so if you had a punctured primer or ruptured case, it's going to try to vent out the side through the ejection port instead of into your eye. Again, the way that this bolt shroud is set up, it's sort of cupped. It's hard for you guys to see. It's cupped to throw everything back forward, so hopefully it all goes out those gas ports. All right, sort of hidden down in the gun where you can't see it as well, we have an ejector that's right in here, and I'm sorry it's not in the camera, but it will be in the animation. Because this is a single shot, they stole the ejection system off of the old Mauser 1871 rifle. The trigger group is from the 98. Again, you'll see that in the animation. But while we're right here and you can see the gun, I'll point out that we have a huge two-piece stock. You can sort of see that dove cut right there. There are examples of one-piecers out there, but 99% of them are two-piecers. And then also we have the pistol grip because, frankly, wrapping your hand around that isn't very likely. Most of these guys will be marked Mauser with the 1918 date below, although some of the very late production ones are just marked with a 1918 in the Mauser banner. Oh, also moving some of this out of my way. Sorry, guys. I'm gonna drag this over. Whoa, and we'll see that we have a bipod mount. It is mostly circular. It's spring-loaded, so I just gotta thumb this guy and pull her away. Here, hold on. Sorry, it's a little bit awkward, gentlemen. There we go. So she just mounts there. That allows for 360 degrees rotation. The plate on the forward barrel band, if you guys can see that, I'm trying to position for the camera monitor. This guy is universal with the MG0815, so it can share bipods, tripods, and other mounts. So, I mean, vehicle equipment mounts and carts and sleds and things like that. The Tankgewehr can go anywhere that the MG can go. Now, the first production version of the Tankgewehr didn't look quite like ours. Instead, it sported a shorter 33.9-inch barrel, which was also quite thick, leading to a heavier weight of 36.6 pounds naked. It also sports a standard Mauser 98-style sight ranged to 2,000 meters, just like the rifle, but that's well beyond the effective range of this gun. Later versions would, of course, like ours, sport a 500-meter sight in 50-meter increments, which is much better for use with the troops so they don't become confused and try to use that too far of a range and basically fire ineffective shots. Only 300 or so would be produced of the first version, and then it would change over to our longer, lighter model, which sports a 37.8-inch barrel and weighs in only at 34.8 pounds when we get rid of the bipod and everything else. The earliest version will generally be known colloquially as the KERS. Internally, the Tankgewehr would be known at Mauser as the elephant gun, for good reason. And the initial cost, as related by the company's financial records, says that the setup took them 700,000 marks, a little more than that, but I'm not memorizing that many numbers, to get this thing ready and rolling. They charged a flat 1,000 marks, which I can remember, to produce each individual gun for the military. All right, with these things rolling off the assembly line, it's probably time to look at that animation and get, you know, better look at, like I said, the ejector and the trigger group. Really, a gun can hardly get much simpler. This is a cock-on-open bolt-action single-shot rifle. But let's go ahead and take note of the older-style ejector rocking below the bolt. That's it, folks, really. But let's shoot a few more just for the fun of it. All right, let's hand this thing over to Mae and really fire it.
I'm just gonna bolt this thing open and toss a round in. I'm ready. Again.
With only 5 rounds, I'm getting in on this.
All right, let's take a look at that recoil. Now, as we look at the target, I need to point some things out. We didn't want to shoot collectible ammo, but luckily the owner actually had 5 reloads available for us to use. Now, these were full-powered, however, they were brass and copper bullets, so they didn't make quite as much of an impact on the 3/4-inch steel targets we had. Now, keep in mind, it's 3/4-inch steel, 4 of them, weigh about 26 pounds each, 2 sandbags on the rig, so about coming up on 130 pounds. So just keep that in mind when you take a look at the following. Now this third round was actually a Bubba bullet. We made it by setting a 1/8 inch tool steel rod into a brass bullet. You can see its significant performance increase. Our tool steel wasn't as hard as the original steel cores, and probably a quarter of the mass. So with a near punch through and massive buckling from this round alone, I'm quite certain original ammo would have torn straight through these plates. Okay, back to Mr. Blah 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 Othais.
Now, I know a lot of you want to see us just punch through everything in sight, and believe me, we set up a target behind ours to make sure that if we did, we'd get some of the effect of the Spall and things like that, but that's not what happened. And the reason, again, is those light brass and copper bullets. I don't really think we should have gone with a lighter plate, though, because if we're just getting down to the thinnest thing possible to punch a hole, we're really not showing you the power of the Tankgewehr. I want to point out that that massive rig was tossed around by brass and copper bullets coming out of this thing. It's very impressive, and I understand it's not as dramatic, but for those of you that are a little more science-minded, I think you'll appreciate that setup more than anything else. If you want a thrill, by all means, we are personal friends with Tal Fledermaus. He will punch some holes in things for you. All right, let's get back into the history. 2 or 3 Tankgewehr were issued per regiment. They would be crewed by 2 men each. The main rifleman would carry the rifle, 20 cartridges, and a toolkit. The bipod was often left mounted, but could easily be tucked into his belt. And the whole gun was carried with a large leather strap. The reserve would carry 2 more 20-round pouches and a further box of 72 cartridges, usually slung over the shoulder. He would also carry a standard rifle or a pistol in order to deal with infantry while the other focused on armor. As for tactics, you have to understand that the Tankgewehr at, let's say, 100 yards is getting roughly 22 millimeters of penetration. This is sort of an average from a bunch of tests that the British and French and Germans did. So 100 yards, 22 millimeters. By 300 yards, you're getting down to 15 millimeters of penetration. And yes, I know I'm mixing my units of measure and that's annoying, but this is literally the data that I had available to me. It drove me crazy too. Anyway, so we know that really past 300 yards, this thing is not all that effective. So when you select men for this crew, they've got to have balls of steel. Remember, you're telling them that they need to go towards tanks. I mean, we're not just a tank, tanks. They always came in groups with infantry behind them. So you've got men and tanks coming at you. You have to go towards them. You have to get close. And you have to whip out this massive thing, which makes you slow and obvious and a big, big target. And you have to fire. You have to fire one round at a time between the two of you. And at the same time, you are making the loudest possible noise on the battlefield short of the tanks themselves. So you are a target. Anyway, so men with balls of steel would go out and fire these at tanks, and usually, if they could, they would try to get at least 3 of these guys firing at the same tank, just at the best chances of riddling with holes and hitting the occupants within. They also liked pairing these things with soldiers with rifles and machine guns firing SMK ammo, so that way they could take advantage of any weaknesses caused by the 13.2 ramming into those riveted plates. As a matter of fact, a pair of leaflets from 1918 provide a chart of preferred targets on French and British tanks for infantry. They are divided into 3 categories: light mortars, Tankgewehr operators, and riflemen with the SMK cartridge. Note that while the riflemen are given soft targets like visors, the Tankgewehr is generally assigned to the task of seeking out the crew inside. Armor plate of the day actually maxes out right at our steel plates that we had at the range. However, most would probably be less than that. That's really the high end. The one thing that is different, though, is armor plate of the day was in large segments and riveted together, which means it was under constant tension. And so when a Tankgewehr round smashed into that thing, even if it did not penetrate, it would cause rippling and buckling, and it would cause those rivets to burst. Now, that combined with any steel shed on the inside from the buckling all created what was known as spalling, and this would fly around inside the cabin and wound and possibly blind anybody inside. The problem was so acute that French and British tank drivers came up with goggles with chainmail masks attached in order to help with defending their precious faces. While spalling was a nuisance, it wasn't the primary aim of the Tankgewehr. Yes, it could blind. Yes, it could keep the gunners distracted. Yes, in rare, rare circumstances, it could stop a tank, although very unlikely. You see, the Tankgewehr was really, honestly designed to seek out critical systems and crew. And so the guns were fielded in such a way that they were instructed, look, just punch for these sections until something stops working. So they would target where they knew the driver would be. They would target where they knew gunners would be. They would target the guns themselves in an attempt to smash the mechanisms. They would target fuel tanks, especially in order to halt the movement of the tank, or if possible, hit the engine compartment. So in other words, the Tankgewehr was not a one-shot deal. There's no expectation of, I'm going to point this one-shot rifle and stop one tank. The expectation was, I'm going to probe at that tank as long as I can until it stops moving, or I do. French records from attack on April 7th, 1918 note two Schneider CA-1s, number 311 and 321, returned from battle riddled with strange 15 to 18 millimeter holes. Shortly after, they would capture a frontline Tankgewehr and realize just what happened. Another report in August would note that while the 15th Squadron had been involved in fierce fighting, they had lost not a single tank to artillery fire. But instead, a commander was killed, four drivers wounded, and two tanks halted by anti-tank rifle fire. Despite these stories, the truth is the presence of the Tankgewehr was barely slowing the armored waves approaching Germany. The resource differences between the Central Powers and the Entente were just too great. While impressive, it's certainly not a perfect rifle, because the Tankgewehr is slow to load, heavy to carry around, awkward to aim. The bipod is fairly tall and it makes you stand out. There's no compensator. There's no recoil management. It's extremely rough on the shooter. As a matter of fact, repeated firers would complain of headaches, dizziness, shoulder pain, stiff necks, things like that. It was often joked that you could fire the rifle twice per man, once for each broken shoulder. A spring-softened butt plate and five-shot magazine were both experimented with, but neither saw production. One improvement, however, was the adoption of a dedicated bipod. Ours here is from an 0815, featuring thin, riveted steel. The small foot pads combined with the heavy barrel meant sinking into the mud and lots of resetting for the next shot. So a wider, flatter-footed bipod with steel rod legs was developed. It was also slightly heavier. While we're talking about variants, I should also point out some of you might have seen a photo of one of these equipped with a scope. That appears to be a fantasy piece. The scope does not match the gun. And also, when you have a maximum 500 meter marking and realistically a maximum 300 meter range against giant armored elephants walking across the battlefield, you don't need a scope. As a matter of fact, I would consider it highly discouraged on a gun like this. Not only that, but I can't imagine a scope would weather too well in the long run, especially scopes back then. Anyway, there really aren't any other improvements to the Tankgewehr because it was really never meant to be a frontline permanent weapon. Remember, it's supposed to be a stopgap as an alternative to the awaited Tankenflieger machine gun. Like we said, production reached 300 units per day. These were serialized in batches of 9,999. Then a letter suffix was applied. So if you have, you know, rifle serial number 5000A, you have the 15,000 rifle. Mauser records that 16,190 of these things were produced, but serial number 64 some odd A has been found. So that means that we're looking at close to 16,500 produced. I'm not sure why Mauser's records were a little off, maybe some fudgery. Who knows? The war was wrapping up anyway. And speaking of the war wrapping up, despite the fact that both sides considered this rifle to be middling at best and probably not the biggest game changer in the war, the Entente at the Treaty of Versailles decided to go ahead and ban these suckers. So Germany was forced to surrender or destroy their Tankgewehrs. A lot were handed over to FN at Belgium as war reparations. Now these would be distributed pretty widely around the world, not in huge numbers for military use, but rather everybody seemed to want to get one to study it. And so immediately after that, we're going to see, you know, native tank rifle designs showing up all over the world. In Germany, the Tankgewehr would eventually be superseded by the Panzerbuchse 38. It's interesting to note a near clone of the gun would serve in Russia at the beginning of World War II, however. Caught short on development when Germany attacked, the Russians would copy the Tankgewehr, now chambered for 12.7 by 108 millimeter, and fitted with a butt pad, muzzle brake, and folding bipod. This is known as the PTR Sholokhov. All right, that's probably enough history on this thing, so I'm going to get this put somewhere to the side and rearrange the room and let May come in here and get to work. All right, we made room for May, and we still have room for the Tankgewehr, barely. So let's go ahead and get her impressions of, you know, handling this thing. I guess we'll start, as we usually do, with the ergonomics.
Thank you. Got it. All right. This thing is big, it's long, and it's heavy. There's no way I'm going to shoulder this thing or fire from the hip. Othais, help me with the bipod. Thank you. We'll set her down. Okay. With the bipod, this thing is actually easy to move around. It swivels, I'm able to dip it up and down. It just, the bipod's carrying all the weight is up here in the front of the gun. There's practically nothing back here, so honestly, I don't perceive this thing being that heavy. I found it was easy to sight in. This was a very comfortable setup for me.
Okay, I'm gonna look over this thing for a moment. What about, say, just the more generic handling, the position of the shoulder, that nice pistol grip, you know, the action, what are we doing in here?
So I found I was easily able to get my cheek down on here. The pistol grip itself was incredibly useful. There was no way I was going to be able to fit my hand around the side of the stock up top. It's too much girth up to here. Now, the bolt itself, while big, it was easy to grab. The action, it's tight, but it's smooth.
All right, well, I guess we'll kind of want to know, what was it like to shoot this thing?
Shooting it was something else. The sight picture was clean. I was able to easily align on my target. The trigger itself was smooth, and while it was a long pull through, clean break, and the recoil. Oh.
So would you say that it was absolutely unmanageable, though? I mean, we definitely saw, with that slowed down footage, you took a good wallop.
You know what? I would actually say the recoil was not as manageable as you would think. We had this set up from me actually in a standing position. Now, originally, we were going to have me sitting down with this, and if I had been sitting down with it, I feel like my back and lower spine would have ended up getting a lot of impact from that recoil. But because I was standing, I was able to shift my weight and have a lot of the recoil basically like go into my hips and my knees. It was almost like my body was able to act as a cushion overall. I didn't really feel like a lot of damage was dealt because of that.
So you'd say that there's definitely a preference to using this over the top of a trench. There's not a lot of inconvenience to sticking this over the wall, standing in the trench, and firing. But, as we know, a lot of these were used prone. Would you like to try it prone?
No. This is not something I would ever want to try prone. I know that even while standing and firing, I can maybe shoot, you know, a dozen, two rounds or so and just enjoy it. But I did still get a small bruise from it, and I could see how shooting it all day would be awful. Laying it prone? I don't even think I could do one or two shots. I have a feeling everything the rumors were true, that this was a collarbone breaker.
Now, I know a lot of you are probably thinking, oh, 50 BMG is more powerful. I've shot 50 BMG. But do recall one key thing about this rifle. There is no mitigation system. There is a hard wood buttstock. There's no compensator. It's all straight through, linear to the rear. There's no cushioning, period. The gun is not built around the cartridge so much as it was built to just not blow up on the cartridge. It's a make-do rifle. All right, well, I guess after that, we gotta ask you, would you take it into World War I?
So, you know, I could see how there are some things about this gun that maybe some people will give a soft no depending on the situation. I mean, it's big and long and awkward. You've got to transport this thing. It doesn't have a lot of range. It's just not ideal for, like, infantry, like fighting infantry or something like that. But if there's a tank coming along, I want this. I need this. This is what's going to protect me. So, yes, I would take it into battle.
Okay, so you're not going to run the line with it, but if you've got a steel elephant coming your way, you'll reach for the elephant, guys.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, well, we won't torture Mae too much further. We can go ahead and wrap out the episode. So, for you at home, I'm sorry that this one isn't quite as easy to collect as the others we've covered, but we're starting to get into the more exotic stuff of the war. As a matter of fact, after we wrap this up, we're switching gears to go try some machine guns. So, more is on the way, and we thank you all every time. Ooh, let me let your face in the shot. We thank you all every time for joining us and going over this history. We really do appreciate our growing number of viewers because we think this information is valuable, and we think it's not necessarily political or limited to the U.S. It's just great knowing that what happened to these men and this equipment 100 years ago and how they tried to fight one of the most impossible fights mankind ever, you know, faced. It was ridiculous all around. By the way, before we get to the updates, I want to say, don't forget we're partnered with the Great War, and for those of you who want more of the sort of day-to-day history of the war itself, it really helps to understand what's going on with these guns, and vice versa. So head on over there if you can. Alright, thanks one last time.
Thanks everyone.
Well, folks, update time. Number one, I want to thank all of our patrons who now have us up to 1390. That is supremely helpful because we are finally pulling ahead of our basic costs. That means I can eat ramen. All right, I should also mention while we're talking about Patreon that I have changed Bug of the Month. During the warm months, we will still try Bug of the Month. It's just not a guarantee anymore. Instead, we've replaced it with something much better for you. I will be doing a journal entry. I'm going to try for once a week. I think that'll work out just fine. It's just going to update people on what's going on with C&Rsenal, although for the first couple, I'm going to be laying out a little bit of the history. So the first one's already up for those at the $5 and up level. That has the story of the first time I shot a firearm. All right, I should also thank our good friend Jeff Carpenter and his two lovely cats, because he provided us the Tankgewehr. Now, he lent this to us over a long period of time while we got ready for a trip to Kentucky, which we have since made. That means two more of Jeff's lovely little machines are on the way, so you're going to hear that name more often. I also have to give a good shout-out to our buddy Olaf and his eBay-based business of small arms parts manufacture. Olaf helped us out back with the Steyr Piper. He's great at making custom firing pins and other small parts, so give him a look. He just told me he rolled out some more rarities. I know a lot of you have been asking me about parts in the comments, so instead of honestly pestering me when I can do nothing about it, you might want to write an email to Olaf. You never know what he can manage to pull off. All right, thanks everyone, and we love you.